This is the Astrology Show podcast with Jessica Adams.
Thanks, Shane. This is your astrology and tarot for the week starting May the 6th. Aries, with the South Node in Libra, the sign of pairs, doubles, duets, you and another person must choose a path, same path, separate path, or something not even on your radar. This other person is the same as you, but different from you. There are a couple of options here in terms of locations. Thinking laterally could be quite useful because the obvious path is not always the right one. You need to move quickly though, get real with each other, be honest and connect, because the financial, property, charity or business situation won't wait for you. One of the reasons for this is that you don't have too long to go in May before Jupiter, with all his solutions, disappears from your zone of property. So time is of the essence. Because you are distracted or diverted or not facing what's really there, according to your chart anyway, it may be time for you to stop looking everywhere except each other and yourselves and really figure out what's going to work. What needs to happen here may be more creative, more unusual than perhaps you had expected. That's what your card is showing this week too. You have the moon, and I'll get onto that in a moment. Taurus, the vision of a mother and a child is never very far away this week. This may be your own son or daughter, if you are a woman. It may be your own mother with you as a child. This may be your wife and children. There are many variations on the theme, but even though it's not front and centre, it's very much in the whole story, according to your chart. At the same time, when it comes to you, never mind your memory of the past or your thoughts about the future, it's pretty clear that you've been through some really big hurdles and therefore you need to adjust, repair, rehabilitate perhaps, and rejuvenate and come back as a new person. If you like, Jupiter and Uranus in Taurus is part of a rebirth for you that had to happen. Certainly, you have been through quite a difficult full moon recently. So if you feel as if you need to take time out, you probably do. Dealing with this question about mothers and children is important, and you'll come to it when you're good and ready. Gemini. Well, this week is one of those weeks in astrology when things are a bit random, and the Wheel of Fortune has turned up as your tarot card, so you will be on a merry-go-round. The whole situation is surrounded by the web, by education, by academia, books, publishing, and all the media. This is also shown in your chart pretty clearly, with Pluto going round in Aquarius. This zodiac sign for you rules readers and writers, authors and publishers, students and lecturers, webmasters, and web users. The Wheel of Fortune is shown in your chart by an asteroid called Fortuna, and there it is in Pisces. Again, the sign of everything that's always moving. It's always in flux. It's never still. So surfing with the tides is a very good idea. What happens this week will take you to the very top of the wave, and you'll be on the crest of a wave, or other people will. And then, of course, it's going to take you all the way down on the other side of the wave and then back up again. So your chart has this kind of topsy-turvy, hurdy-gurdy feeling. When that happens, what you can hang on to is your sense of humour and also your philosophical angle on life, Gemini. Cancer. If you are a man, you will be negotiating, trading, bargaining, and so on this week. The answer is not certain yet for you, or perhaps for a second man, yes, no, or maybe. If you're a woman, this is your husband, bank manager, brother, father, business partner, and so on. Pluto in Aquarius is showing up as a powerful man whose control comes from his finances. You tend to get freedom and liberation questions on this kind of transit. And the other reason for this is Uranus in Taurus in your second house natally. So when it comes to men and money, or you and money if you are a man, there is a price tag here on being free. You may be dealing with somebody who has let his financial situation grow up all around him, or you may personally be feeling as if you are surrounded with agreements, contracts, security, the material world, and yet you don't have the space or the independence. All of this has to be answered one way or another by Sunday. And actually, there may be a deal. Somebody may be prepared to buy or sell or make a change. Or perhaps if you're a male Cancerian, you will be. Leo, with your finance, charity, business and property zone occupied by Saturn and Neptune, you have the hard reality but also the escape from it this week. If it's an escape, then you will be on the receiving end of favours, a loan, a grant, a handout, or a generous pay settlement. And if you are on the other side of things, then you will be providing the escape for others. There's a real sense here of the haves and the have-nots this week. This is also showing up in your natal chart with so many transits in the sign of Taurus, which rules bull markets on Wall Street and also gold bullion. Taurus is the very image of money and values. The only question really about this exchange of money is where it lands you or the other person in terms of obligation and the whole philosophical side of the question, because whenever this happens, there's always a bit of a power imbalance. Virgo, in your natal chart, Pluto in Aquarius is about the power of a group, especially when that circle or community is against one person. Pluto is also about transformation, and what happens this week changes you and changes the group. It changes everything. It may be a scenario with one male, two or more females. In your Virgo chart, Vesta is in your zone of teams, societies, clubs, political parties, and networks, and she always turns up when there's a gender imbalance. But you also have Apollo in the same space. So there's a question here about taking the lead or being in the lead with the group. If you're in the group, it's about the outsider. If you are the outsider, Virgo, it's about dealing with that collective community of people. There is a new day dawning here, though, so this situation doesn't last. But while it's there, it is really going to transform everything. Libra, the High Priestess is your tarot card this week. If you are a woman, you will publish, graduate, or be put in place as the authority, professionally or online, the voice of wisdom, the expert. Of course, if you are a female, there is a chance that this is not you, but another woman, academic, author, and so on. If you're a man, this is your employer, your wife, girlfriend, mother, and all those women in your world who you might classify as the voice of wisdom. You have Minerva in Gemini in your chart this week in your ninth house, which rules the bigger picture of knowledge. Minerva is a bit of a godsend. She is a blessing to see in the chart, and she's also represented by the High Priestess, a major arcana card. So this is actually a major week. No matter if you've got something to say or write, or whether you are about to receive that wisdom from a second woman. At the same time, your horoscope is suggesting that there is a gap to be bridged here and that the knowledge will bridge that gap. Scorpio, with Neptune in Pisces in your sector of children, young adults, and the next generation, your son or daughter may be in a world of their own this week. If you are child-free, this may be your work experience student or just a portion of the population which is younger than you. On another planet? Absolutely. Not grounded? Definitely. Your tarot card shows an effeminate younger male, or is it a masculine female holding a fish in a cup? Of course, this is intensely fashionable among the younger generation at the moment, but what do you do with the situation? There is a definite gap in understanding or reality function between you, he and she. Therefore, you have to speak their language if you're going to talk to them. But most of all, I think, in this tarot card this week, but also in your chart, there is something so precious, so valuable that they are in possession of that it would be a shame to see it wasted. Sagittarius, the Seven of Cups is your tarot card this week. Neptune in Pisces is making a big splash in your horoscope. And whenever you get this tarot card, you get the need to understand that you're actually projecting things and that what you're seeing is not really there. at the moment, this is going to be very much about a house or apartment, maybe a property investment that's in your sights. Therefore, you need to understand that, according to the tarot and the astrology, coming back to yourself, knowing yourself, owning who you are and being in touch with yourself is a better way of handling things. You can have this. It's not just a projection. And the reassuring thing is, at the same time, that what or who haunts you or what or whom you find a bit toxic isn't real either. In fact, it's no more real than the fantasy of a particular property or residence. So if you come back to yourself, you can actually make steps towards banishing what you don't want and moving towards what you do want, particularly with a home. Capricorn. When a woman has money, the only question is how to save it, spend it, give it away, or invest it. This is you most likely if you are a female. If you are a man, this may be your boss, wife, girlfriend, mother, and so on. Sometimes you can be a female Capricorn and immediately know that this is a well-heeled woman in your world. This is Pluto in Aquarius with all its power, and money really is power. Taking your time with deciding what to do, or understanding that she has to take her time before she figures out her life budget, is part of the bargain because Pluto moves so very slowly. However, a decision will come out of this by Sunday. Aquarius. Well, we have to ask what the big idea is. You have a lot of factors in Aries this week in your zone of brainwaves, concepts, and plans. And Aries is a fast-paced sign. So this will be a bolt from the blue and you have to act quickly before it disappears as quickly as it arrived. If it remains in your head or on paper or on your computer, then nothing will happen and nobody will make anything happen either. So this has to be planted somewhere where it's going to grow. The location is absolutely crucial for this notion or this concept because there are so many places where it could land and not work, but there is one place where it very much could, and it's worth your time and the time of people around you to try and find where that place might be. Pisces, Ceres in your group and friend zone is about sharing and compromising. Part of the deal is that you all understand that you are very different and you need your space. Yet Ceres is also so productive and creative. There is something here to use, Pisces. Ceres is about terrific resources, a harvest, and together you could all live in the moment and celebrate your good fortune, or you could do something sensible and start using what is there for the future. This transit is quite long. It runs until the end of 2024. And so there is potential there for you all to harness what is there and how to make sure that it goes on rewarding you next year, the year after, and so on. Nobody can be quite sure about this tarot card, the Three of Cups, which turns up for you. Are they all women or are they a mixed group of people? But one thing is sure, you need to use what you've been given. Your tarot card can be read in detail at jessicaadams.com this week, and it is Aries, the Moon, Taurus, the Four of Swords, Gemini, the Wheel of Fortune, Cancer, the King of Pentacles, Leo, the Six of Pentacles, Virgo, the Ten of Swords, Libra, the High Priestess, Scorpio, the Page of Cups, Sagittarius, the Seven of Cups, Capricorn, the Queen of Pentacles, Aquarius, the Ace of Wands, and Pisces, the Three of Cups. Fated connections this week are Cancer and Capricorn, the King and Queen of Pentacles, leading lights with finance. Leo is tied in, they give or receive quite dramatically. Famous Taurus birthdays this week include Steve Diggle, who is 69, Chris France, who is 73, Dave Garn, who is 62, Paul Heaton, who is 62, Bono, who is 64, Sid Vicious would have been 67, Libra Lowe would have been 72, Ian Dury would have been 82, Bert Bacharach would have been 96. If it's your birthday, then what you set up at the end of May 2024 could make or save you a lot of money by June and be the gift that goes on giving from 2026. You could call it freedom. Babies born this week are strongly Aries and will always push to be first or come first. They are by nature competitive and may also compete with their siblings. In your natal chart, on May the 7th, the Sun at 17 Taurus 09 is sextile Saturn at 17 Pisces 09. If you have anything at 17 degrees in your chart, this is about accepting the barriers, the walls, the obstacles, and the fences. Other people may have them, which affects you, or you may have them, in which case you need a plan. So the spotlight is very much on Saturn this week, and understanding Saturn's transit in Pisces is useful. But what is this planet all about? People talk about their Saturn return as if it's the worst thing ever, but actually it's just the return of a situation that you were always born to experience that's a bit like learning to drive, getting your L plates in life. Your Saturn return comes along between the age of 28 and 30, and it repeats in another 28 to 30 years. So as you approach your 30s, but also your 60s, you find that Saturn comes into play and you are required to accept what you cannot change. In your own birth chart, Saturn by zodiac sign and house will show you situations which are impossible to get out of, but also very difficult to get into. There's a bit of that going on this week, and you'll notice it amongst the people around you and perhaps with you yourself. As I said, if you have anything at 17 degrees in your chart, you'll probably feel it more than most. So this sense of being gated or barricaded in or out is very close. The zodiac sign that Saturn transits or travels through tells us where this happens on a world level. And Pisces is the sign of Christianity, the fishes. It's also the sign of religion, full stop, and your belief in God or your rejection of God. And sure enough, we have what amounts to a holy war taking place. Saturn in Pisces is associated with the very basic realities of religion and all that it means. If you were born with Saturn in Pisces, for example, you may have been born into a religion that you could not get out of because you were only a baby at the christening font. Pisces is also very much, when you're older, about situations which are invisible to other people but very real to you. So this may be the world of the psychic, the spiritual, the religious, as I've mentioned. It may be the world of hypnosis or therapy. It's very much the inner life and the inner self. And if you do have Saturn in Pisces, what you're experiencing as Saturn goes through Pisces is your Saturn return. If you were born with Saturn in Aries in the first house of image, identity, appearance, and reputation, then you are saddled with the look that you have, the face, head, and body that you have, and you have to accept it because there are situations that mean you can't get out or you can't get in because of it. So, for example, you may be born very tall, which means that it's impossible for you to take certain professions. And you may be born very short, which means that you'll never really be a ballet dancer. It's on that level. As you grow older, you get to understand Saturn, whatever sign he's in, and learn to live with it. But your Saturn return certainly is a time to be more conscious of the requirement of time and space, because Saturn rules the passage of time. And if you try to rush things, it's never going to work for you. Saturn in Taurus is very much about how you process situations with the money, business or property, the charity or possessions that you cannot get out of and cannot get into. So you may be born with rich parents, for example, who give you an inheritance at birth, and that requires an obligation to them. It can feel like being locked into a bargain, not with the bank manager, but with your mother or your father. At the same time, Saturn in Taurus is well known in astrology for bringing about situations which are tough and restrictive financially, and your Saturn return is about accepting what you cannot change about, for example, a mortgage. If you're born with Saturn in the sign of Gemini, then a brother, sister, or cousin is the symbol of fences and walls and gates. Again, you cannot get out of the situation, or you may find it hard to get into a situation because of them. The sibling in question may represent Saturn to you, and Saturn is quite a heavy symbol in astrology associated with lead weight. So you may find that your sibling or your cousin is a very restrictive presence for you or a big learning experience. If you have Saturn in Cancer in your fourth house of the family, then you are going to be born into a family, which of course you can't escape from. Even if you run away from home, you're never going to quite get over the wall. At the same time, this sign in your chart is very much about your house or apartment, your hometown and homeland. And you may be born into a time in history when your homeland or your hometown won't let you out or let you go. So that's also a feature of Saturn in Cancer. Cancer is about the sign of the mother and motherhood, so your own mother, your grandmother, or your great-grandmother on either side may also be that heavy Saturn presence. If you were born with Saturn in Leo, in the fifth house of your chart, then courtship, the bedroom, babies, infants, children, and teenagers all suggest a bit of a learning curve for you. And as you go from 28 to 30, it may be that your biological clock is ticking, or you find that your children are growing up and you have to accept more responsibility than you ever thought for them. Saturn in Leo is also a reminder that between 28 and 30, people who are not married begin to look at questions about marriage. And again, as you go towards 60 and the second Saturn return, it's time to look at life with a partner into old age. Saturn is not exactly a walk in the park, but it will teach you. If you have Saturn in Virgo, the sign of health and well-being, the first thing most astrologers will tell you to do is take out good health insurance, and insurance that comes not from paying for it, but actually making sure that you do all the right things with your diet, your fitness, and so on. Saturn in Virgo is associated with the body, mind, and spirit. So this isn't just physical. It can also be on the level of mental health as well. Saturn is really about accepting what you can't change, and we all have it somewhere. In Virgo, it's also very much about work. So at an early age, you may want to get into a routine or a lifestyle where you can make work work for you. If you have Saturn in Libra, in the seventh house of marriage, work partnership, de facto relationships, and all kinds of duets, the lesson for you between 28 and 30 is about the other person. Libra, the scales of justice can sometimes bring legal matters into play around that age, but it's usually about the harmony or symmetry between you and the other person on all sorts of levels, not just official or on paper. You have to be careful who you marry if you have Saturn in this sign, because if you make a mistake between 28 and 30, you really have to manage it. If you were born with Saturn in Scorpio in the eighth house of joint finance and property, this is about an inheritance, will or legacy, a trust fund. It's about marriage and mortgage, and it's very much about what you leave to others as well as what is left to you. This is the sort of Saturn placement where an extra pair of eyes on paperwork is very useful, a second or third professional opinion, and also an awareness of what you're actually getting into when you sign on the dotted line of, say, a marriage contract. Saturn in Scorpio has a way of making you slow down, even if you want to rush into a property arrangement, for example. Saturn in Scorpio will show you the hard way that you actually have to take the long way. If you have Saturn in Sagittarius, then foreign people and foreign countries are your big learning experience, and it may come through the world of academia, or books, or the World Wide Web. So before you set off on your gap year or your big world tour, you may want to check out what the transits are to natal Saturn, because Saturn in Sagittarius in the ninth house has a way of showing you what's real about the world and the people in it, and not what you'd like to believe. So, for example, if you're setting off for a foreign country with a foreign language and culture and belief system, you need to be absolutely aware of what you're taking with you in terms of your knowledge as well as your luggage. If you're born with Saturn in Capricorn, then your career, your unpaid work, or your academic career is where you have to learn the hard way, as you might expect. And sometimes you find people changing careers midstream between 28 and 30 because they can no longer work at the job that they took when they started out. It's also the sort of age when people go back to university as a mature age student because they realise that the only way forward is to know more. Naturally, when you sign up for a job, if you were born with Saturn in Capricorn, you need to read the fine print on the contract because it's likely to be heavier than you ever expected. If you were born with Saturn in Aquarius, then friends and groups are where you do your learning. So this is quite common in the music industry because groups are a big, heavy commitment for those in it. At the same time, you find it in sport. Cricket is never just cricket if you have Saturn in the 11th house of groups. You also need to be quite careful with the friends that you make and what friendship actually means. And this is more important as you go through this transit over the next 20 years that they call Pluto in Aquarius, because Pluto in Aquarius will totally transform the group and groups plural. It will change a friendship. So being born with Saturn in Aquarius is something that you need to take a bit more seriously on this cycle. Finally, if you were born with Saturn in the sign of Pisces, to take us right back to the beginning, you are going through your Saturn return or you have just finished it. The thing about this planet in all cases is you need to absorb it. You can't just go into it and say that you've done the astrology and got on with your life. It can take a bit of time to understand just how heavy Saturn actually is. The metal associated with this planet is lead, as I've mentioned, and it can feel as if you're holding something in your life that weighs a lot more than you ever anticipated. That takes time, and time it will take. So that's the wrap-up of Saturn this week, traveling through the sign of Pisces. Thank you for listening, and I'll catch up with you next week.